and online at kbfa.org. It is 1:30. Up next is Making Contact.
This week on Making Contact...
The task of the revolutionary artist is to make revolution irresistible.
In the early 1900s, activist Emma Goldman said something like this: "If I can't dance, I don't want to be in your revolution." Well, in the past decade, more and more political marching bands have been invigorating social movements. And in some cases, they are the protests themselves.
Wait a second, honey. We can't check in here. This hotel's under boycott.
On this edition of Making Contact, we look at how musicians are stirring up public spaces from the streets to supermarkets to your Facebook feed. I'm Sandina Robbins, and this is Making Contact, a program connecting people, vital ideas, and important information. Marching bands from North Carolina to Portland, Oregon are bringing humor, politics, and a unique sound to the streets, many of them with a message of social justice. Once a year, street bands travel to Massachusetts for the Honk Festival. Sarah Danson has more about the festival and the historical and political traditions behind the music.
It's noon on a crisp, sunny day in October in Somerville, Massachusetts. A small park in Davis Square is filled with musicians carrying a variety of shiny brass instruments. They look as colorful as their music sounds, and they are wearing what seems like the contents of a child's play closet. One guy is wearing a skin-tight lime green bunny suit. Musicians are warming up their instruments while observers mill about, taking in the beautiful day. They're all waiting for the start of the 4th annual Honk Festival, a weekend-long event dedicated to street bands. That's the Pink Puffins. They're just one of the 28 alternative marching bands represented here. These groups of musical artists are also known as radical brass bands, marching bands, do-it-yourself brass bands, activist street bands, the clandestine brass underground, and honk bands. Sarah Valentine, a dancer with the Hungry March Band in New York, prefers a broader term, global brass. She says the movement is influenced by a do-it-yourself punk aesthetic and attitude.
Anybody can make music, pick up a guitar, play three chords. It's the same idea. Like, anybody can play music, pick up a brass instrument, pick up a drum, choreograph a simple dance routine, and you can have this community project that's exciting and fun and participatory and uplifting and grassroots and something that people can share together.
The music these bands play isn't what you'd hear in a high school marching band. It's loud, it's primarily heard on the street, and it takes from brass music from around the world. Members of the bands are generally in their 20s or 30s, and they're having fun.
Hungry March Band didn't start to, like, create a revolution. Hungry March Band was formed by a bunch of people that wanted to make noise and make a spectacle.
While some bands may be more interested in revolution than others, just the very nature of them challenges the status quo, says Daniel Lang Levitsky of the Rude Mechanical Orchestra, or the RMO, in Brooklyn.
The way that I think about it is that, broadly in general, any street brass project, whether or not it thinks it is a political project in the way that it takes up public space, doesn't rely on the apparatus of a club, amplification, etc., and the way that it's a fundamentally participatory musical experience. But within that broader realm of street bands, there's the group of bands that RMO is part of, which are explicitly political projects that exist to support social justice movements.
The Rude Mechanical Orchestra is one of these bands. Lang Levitsky says that from day one, the band has played to support many different causes and has risked arrest to do so.
We talk about the band as having formed for the 2004 mobilization against the Republican National Convention in New York, which was mainly focused on the one hand on anti-war organizing and on the other hand on a set of local issues mainly affecting poor and working class communities of color. But before the band existed and had a name and a structure, its actual birth point was for the earlier in 2004 March for Women's Lives in D.C. We tend to get talked about as much more of a group with a history of working on anti-war stuff and on the class and race issues in the city, but paired with that from the very beginning has been feminist and queer and trans issues, which also very much reflects the makeup of the band.
Lang Levitsky says the RMO and other street bands connect to larger political movements, both past and present, by playing their music.
The history of solidarity between movements in different places has been a history of learning each other's music and singing together. I mean, I come from a red diaper family. I grew up singing radical songs with slightly butchered pronunciation in four or five languages. And that's something that if you talk to folks who were, who've been part of radical movements pretty much anywhere, that gets talked about as what makes movements connect to each other is in part being able to sit down with folks and sing together and play music together.
In the past decade, political street bands have become a vibrant part of many protests. Many were inspired by the Infernal Noise Brigade at the 1999 WTO protests in Seattle. But the history of these bands goes back much further. In the 1960s, one notable group used brass music in anti-war protests. Michelle Hardesty was a founding member of the Rude Mechanical Orchestra.
One group that was based in New York City back in the 60s and is now up in rural Vermont is Bread and Puppet Theater, who have always combined political theater, puppet theater, with street music. They've always had a brass band playing along with their actions and with their shows. They started in the Lower East Side back in the 1960s doing anti-war, Vietnam anti-war actions, and have continued to this day, coming to and inspiring others to do combined kind of performance, cultural performance with political action.
In the United States, brass music is very often associated with military music. Even in that context, though, it has had major social influences. In World War I, the famed Harlem Hellfighters, or the 369th Infantry Regiment, was the first African-American regiment. They were also highly decorated by the French, and they had a brass band led by James Reese Europe that brought ragtime music to Europe for the first time. But perhaps the most famous street bands in America are New Orleans bands. These bands often played at funerals around the turn of the century. They were arranged by social aid and pleasure clubs, which were founded to give newly freed slaves loans, legal counsel, and education. Balkan brass is also a strong influence. The songs of the Romani, more commonly referred to as gypsies, are another musical favorite of these bands because of their link to oppression. This is the Hungry March Band's version of Kalashnikov, the theme to the Serbian film Underground. But perhaps the most universally played song by political alternative marching bands is Bella Ciao. Bella Ciao is an anti-fascist Italian song about a partisan fighter who's preparing to die for liberty. It's a well-known protest song and appeals to the political nature of some of the bands. Here are the Brass Messengers of Minneapolis playing their version.
Una mattina mi son svegliato, oh bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, 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 una mattina mi son svegliato.
purpose of these bands is that
Michelle Hardesty.
It's like bringing music back to the street, back to just like public spaces. It's celebrating public spaces. It's celebrating the potential for anyone to pick up an instrument and learn it and play together in a big band.
Daniel Lang-Levitsky of the Rude Mechanical Orchestra.
There's a wonderful line of Tony K. Bambara's that the task of the revolutionary artist is to make revolution irresistible. And that is a lot of what we do.
For Making Contact, I'm Sarah Danson.
While there are now dozens of street bands around the country and abroad, one from Seattle is known to have been an inspiration. The Infernal Noise Brigade debuted at the Seattle World Trade Organization protests in 1999. Jill Friedberg from KBCS in Seattle has their story.
On November 30th, 1999, protesters locked down the Seattle streets and shut out the WTO delegates. And for 5 days, the Infernal Noise Brigade helped keep them going. Jenna Barrett joined the IMB for its Seattle debut.
Demonstrations in general, I think, can get bogged down in walking through the streets and sometimes retracing your own steps, and it can feel really repetitive and you get very tired. And music is inspirational. It gives people something to march to.
When the 18-member band rounded the corner flanked by thousands of demonstrators, their appearance inspired the crowds as much as their music did.
We had two rifle twirlers and we had four flag bearers.
Yi Ching was a member of the Infernal Noise Brigade's Flag and Rifle Corps.
Our initial colors started off as being green and black, and one of the uniform pieces that we had were furry black kind of Russian-style hats.
The rifles, of course, weren't real. It was all part of what Jenna Barrett called their playfully pseudo-military look.
When you added the boots that we all wore and the gas masks and the cloths that we used to cover our faces, I think we looked pretty militant, and that certainly wasn't our original intent. Like, that kind of came out of the pragmatism part of it.
Their uniforms had to be pragmatic. The band often placed itself on the front lines between police and protesters.
By staying there and just holding our ground, playing music, it helped to keep people there as well. It became more of a force to be reckoned with, in a sense.
In the months leading up to the WTO protests, the Infernal Noise Brigade rehearsed along Seattle's industrial waterfront, surrounded by 40-foot shipping containers. When it rained, they played music under a highway overpass. Yi Ching attended those early rehearsals.
Many of the members that became part of the Infernal Noise Brigade all had some type of experience in social activism. But for the most part, none of us had been in any group where there's marching involved. We had people who came and advised us in how to march. We had a woman who came in and taught us how to do rifle twirling. And that was incredibly helpful because, you know, a lot of us had no idea how to do some of this stuff.
Despite being on the front lines, not a single member of the Infernal Noise Brigade was among the 600 people arrested during those 5 days of protest. It was a watershed moment. The WTO meetings were successfully shut down, and globalization became a household word.
At that historical moment, we felt like we had a tool, and we should use it.
Gray Philistine was one of the founding members of the INB.
It seemed like we were actually gaining ground. We were making an impact. We were actually making a hell of a lot of noise, and they had to listen to it.
It changed my life. And the Infernal Noise Brigade specifically absolutely gelled that day.
That was just such a springboard for the INB. It inspired us to want to continue doing it, to provide that energy in other cities.
We'll be right back with Jill Friedberg's story about the Infernal Noise Brigade in Seattle. You're listening to Marching for Change, Street Bands in the U.S. on Making Contact, a production of the National Radio Project. If you'd like more information or for CD copies of this program, please call 800-529-5736. To find out how to support us, download shows, or get our podcasts, go to radioproject.org. We now return to Jill Friedberg's segment about the Infernal Noise Brigade.
After the Seattle protests, large mobilizations against global financial institutions erupted all over the globe, and the INB was there. The band traveled to Prague, Mexico, Scotland, New York.
It allowed me the opportunity to express the way that I feel about authority.
Ronika Sanyal was teaching martial arts to sex workers in India before she joined the INB as a vocalist.
Authority has no place in creating beauty or vision or, you know, communities that are sustainable in this world. And that was one thing that the INB was committed to doing, is not respecting authority.
For I Ching, traveling abroad with the Infernal Noise Brigade was also an opportunity to learn.
We got to experience what it was like to mobilize with people from other countries. To be able to participate and show solidarity was such like this wonderful experience. I remember I just almost wanted to cry.
I left the INB for several reasons. Some of them are definitely political.
Throughout the INB's six-year run, consecutive waves of band members came and went. Many moved on for personal reasons. Others, like Ronika Sanyal, left in part for ideological reasons. Within the resistance movements for which the INB provided a soundtrack, as well as within the band, people began asking this question. Was it effective to travel to protests around the world, or did it make more sense to work locally to address root causes of social and economic injustice?
I didn't feel that where the INB was at that time was where I felt like I was politically, and the things that I was interested in doing and the work that I was interested in doing weren't reflected. Which is not to say that the INB wasn't crucial, just more that my role in the INB wasn't crucial.
It became a system of diminishing returns, like anything.
Gray Philistine, again.
The first couple times, really powerful, really strong. Each time you go, you feel like people are getting tired of these tactics. You reach a point at which you're like, no, this doesn't work anymore. And actually, that means, what is our purpose as a band? And should we continue to exist?
The Infernal Noise Brigade decided to disband in 2006. Naturally, it didn't end quietly.
The actual funeral party was one of the best events I've ever participated in my life. We had like a whole weekend-long funeral party, played with like 40 people in the band, almost everybody had ever played in the group. Had a giant meal together. I mean, it was just a perfect way to end this whole project.
4 years after the Infernal Noise Brigade's funeral, Jenna Barrett insists that music and art still have a vital role to play in resistance movements.
I felt like we'd done a lot of good work. I felt like the people that we had supported and the work that we'd done had really made a difference. In fact, one of my strongest tenets of belief personally is that we live in a nation that has the strongest military in the world. We are never going to be able to outfight them, ever. What we do have is our capacity for play, our capacity for joy, our capacity for comedy, and they'll never get it. They'll never get it. They'll never be able to fight it.
Hey! For Making Contact, I'm Jill Friedberg with KBCS in Seattle.
Some bands are getting even more creative about making a spectacle and using the internet to take their message viral. For Making Contact's Pauline Bartoloni, the subject is close to home. She shares a house with members of the Brass Liberation Orchestra in San Francisco.
When Jamie Spector's sister moved to the San Francisco Bay Area, the two immediately started talking about starting a radical brass band. Her sister was in one in Italy, and Jamie had seen her in action.
And so about 15 of us started playing in someone's living room, and I picked up the trombone for the first time and started learning from a friend who just sort of taught me the positions and enough that I could play a bass line on a song.
So in 2002, the band hit the streets as the Brass Liberation Orchestra, or the BLO. The idea was, and is, to support unity within the left. In the beginning, they were playing a lot at anti-war rallies in San Francisco. They played their music in hopes of de-escalating the tension, as opposed to encouraging confrontation. Over the years, the band has seen dozens of members come and go and come back again. The BLO has been spotted at environmental justice marches against the Chevron oil refinery. They've played at co-op block parties, political fundraisers, Cinco de Mayo, and the U.S. Social Forum. But recently, the BLO decided to make a different sort of political spectacle of themselves. In 2010, thousands of hotel workers in San Francisco were facing increased healthcare costs and workloads. So the BLO teamed up with a group called Pride at Work to encourage a hotel boycott over Gay Pride weekend. They changed the lyrics to Lady Gaga's song Bad Romance to Bad Hotel. Two of them dressed up as a lesbian couple in business suits and pretended to book a room, while the rest of the band trickled into the lobby. Jamie Spector was there.
And so they were having this dialogue with the staff there about rates and rooms and what rooms and should they upgrade and da-da-da. And then when they saw the sousaphone and the bass drum, then they started and one of them shouted, you know, wait, we can't stay here. This hotel's under boycott.
Wait a second, honey. We can't check in here. This hotel's under boycott.
Oh, no. Don't get caught in a bad hotel.
Singing, and then when she started singing, everyone else started singing and dancing, and we started playing. And the hotel security there did nothing. I mean, they were quite overwhelmed.
It was a flash mob protest with a choreographed dance routine and a camera rolling. The video of the event got 250,000 hits on YouTube. A Huffington Post article linked to the video and called flash mobs the new face of political protest. Now, the idea of doing flash mobs themselves are going viral. A different radical brass band invaded a Target store to protest that corporation's anti-gay political donations. And rumor has it that the Yes Men used the lyrics to an earlier BLO flash mob song when the group occupied a Whole Foods supermarket to protest the CEO's stance on healthcare reform. The flash mob idea isn't anything new, but it's not often used for political purposes. Ophir Uziel plays alto sax with the BLO. He was at the first flash mob the group did at the Whole Foods in 2009. He compared the scene to watching fireworks.
I think people were in shock. It's kind of like somebody called the police. That's the reaction. Like, it's kind of hesitant mode and kind of let them finish and everything will be okay. People didn't understand if it's a good thing or a bad thing. And that's great because, you know, we continue to do our thing and they can think in their own terms if it's good or bad.
Uziel says it's hard to tell what the impact of the action is, but it's not really about what happens on that day. Uziel says the flash mobs are a good way to get media attention and convey political messages, but they may not be so revolutionary.
People can be more active through that channel and create communities online. The disadvantage is that you disassociate yourself from the streets, which is it's a big part of the civil rights action and movements. And, you know, people get upset, they go to the streets, they go to City Hall, you know. And if we continue with a trend of like, oh, I don't want to be in the street, I don't want to interface with, you know, actual people, you create division of class and race, and you are excluded to the people that you know online, and what you know online, the people that get you the links or whatever. So in terms of access and exposure, there is advantages and disadvantages.
The BLO is still doing flash mobs, but it prioritizes supporting direct actions in local communities. Activist groups invite them to play for their causes. Deciding what gigs to play requires a monthly meeting, as the BLO operates by consensus.
Are there any questions about this gig? Or people?
The band asks political groups to answer questions to help them consider what gigs they'll play.
Two questions that get more into the politics, like what is the role and leadership of people of color in the organizing of this action? What is the participation of the relevant communities? Was anyone from that neighborhood involved in planning this action, or is this sort of this outside idea that's getting put here?
I think I'll go ahead and...
Jamie Spector says from the start, they knew they wanted to play world music, so they had to have politics around cultural appropriation.
Because it is so common for particularly sort of European or European-descended people to play and use and exploit and profit from music from oppressed people from around the world, that it's important that we say something about what our thinking is around that. So we do play music from around the world. Our goal is to do it as respectfully as we can, you know, and to identify the music that we're playing, to give credit where credit's due, to educate people about the history of a song that we play.
In a sense, the Brass Liberation Orchestra is in itself a political project. What they play, how and where they choose to play it, and how the group operates, it's all based on their desire for social justice. Like many groups on the left, they do struggle with diversity. While no one person speaks for the BLO, I think all members would agree the band is a work in progress, where creating something different is as important as the music. Ophir Uziel.
The compromise is that the music will be a little bit cranky or noisy or off-tune a little bit sometimes. When the energy is high and we do our best with love and with the energy for just cause, it doesn't matter that it's not a perfect sound, that if we are not really perfecting our musical skills, it doesn't matter. We are just dancing like crazy. So.
For Making Contact, I'm Pauline Bartolone.
That's it for this edition of Making Contact. Special thanks to Eric Klein, Jeff Giaquinto, and Rachel Kozlowski. You can find our podcast and download past shows at radioproject.org. Making Contact is supported by listeners like you. Thank you, and thanks for listening to Making Contact.
Hey, it's Ife, and the Hip Hop Takeover is coming Saturday, June 25th at midnight. This year, we pay tribute to hip hop's pioneers, legends, and icons. Special guest hosts include Afrika Bambaataa, DJ Tony Tone from the Cold Crush Brothers. Hear interviews from Sha Rock, Uncle Ralph McDaniels, and more.
The Hip Hop Takeover, this Friday night, Saturday morning, from 12 midnight all the way to 9 a.m. And Saturday morning at 9 a.m. will be a special block report with JR. Check it out.
For more info, you can visit
the application deadline for the KPFA First Voice Media Apprenticeship Program is today at 5 p.m. For more information, call 510-848-6700.